Atia's congratulations to Manjari for this wonderful piece of work. I have known Manjari for practically over a decade now. We started on the HEAL platform itself, the Nutritionist Republic, and then went on. And since then, believe me, I have been following Manjari very closely. I have been attending her lectures, webinars, and definitely TV debates. She's such an eloquent speaker. And now this book writing, you have done a wonderful job, because people can read it, then there are confusion, they can go back and forth, refer to the book. And I'm sure everyone will enjoy reading this book on Eat Up and Clean Up. And I'm really feeling so thrilled, honored, and proud to launch this book.
Shagun, those are really, really beautiful words, and my heartiest gratitude to Dr. Jitendra Kumar. He's one of the people I really look up to, and thank you for the lovely words, sir. I'll not take much of your time. We'll move on to the panel discussion, but I wanted to do a couple of minutes of book reading. So I'm going to read a few pages from the book, a couple of them. The first page that I'm reading is actually from the first chapter of the book. It's called Nutrition: From a Need to a Trade. To start the reading, unfortunately, we have gotten all tangled up in the sticky web of specialty diets and healthy ingredients that promise to burn our pockets. The focus has now shifted from eating healthy to losing weight. And that translates to the end justifies all means philosophy. Teenagers and young adults choose to cut carbohydrates and all kind of fat from their diet to desperately attempt to lose weight, forgetting that in these formative years of lives, they are eliminating essential micronutrients. As I consult individuals in the clinics or talk to multiple people at various platforms, conferences, workshops, I'm amazed at the fact that the questions stay basic and simple. Many highly educated, well-read, and informed people I speak to ask questions that show that there is an overload of confusing and contradictory information. Questions like, what oil should I use? Is ghee okay, or is olive oil a better choice? Should I eat any fat in my diet, or should I go completely fat-free? Is green tea better than my brewed masala tea? My masala tea makes me happy, whereas green tea makes me really grumpy. Is it safe to use a sweetener? How many servings in which category of sweetener is safe? Should I drink cold-pressed vegetable juice or 100% Tetra Pak juice? If I don't eat carbs at night, how do I sleep peaceful, hungry, deprived stomach? Why is everybody shifting to chia seeds? Are they better than the melon seeds that I've been eating all my life? This book essentially attempts to answer such basic questions and links them to fact and a traditional cultural knowledge. A little more, please. Fast food. A little note on fast food. Fast food, you know, may sound like a modern thing, but its roots date back to the early 1900s. Thanks to a number of factors, including modernization, mechanizations, feminist movements, increase in quality of life, social progress, and more importantly, the world wars. However, the markets actually took off in the second half of the 20th century, when women shouldered the responsibility of earning breads for their family. Entrepreneurs were quick to acknowledge that they had a consumer base in which hands they could shell, or they had the bucks to shell out, but had scarcity of time to take care of their food and nutrition. A study titled Food Processing, A Century of Change, which was published by the Oxford Journal, stated, with the increasing standard of living, women soon understood that restaurants could be good alternatives to their home cooking. The feminist movements of the period proposed automated food chains and centralized kitchens. The main goal was to liberate women from the drudgery of home cooking, which was time-consuming and at the same time very costly. The concept of ready-cooked food soon spread around the country. Fast food describes food products that can be prepared and served very quickly. fast food is actually a typically anything that you see, which is a fast food meal of a burger with pies and a cola. Do you know that a normal fast food serving contains around 1200 kilocalories, typically more than the amount recommended for a sedentary adult? The cola alone, apart from its caffeine and its coloring, contains more than 8 teaspoons of sugar. Although this meal is macro and energy dense, it's deprived of micronutrients. You know, the fast food industry is increasing. McDonald's, the world's largest hamburger chain, serves at least 13,000 customers a minute, or more than 98 million customers every week. This is not surprising, since fast food is so affordable and convenient for all age groups. A survey has found that around 25% of adolescents in India visit fast food outlets once a week at least. But many dishes that we eat outside can be replicated at home with a much healthier twist. And that makes a lot of difference.